Let us ask for peace from the God of all peace. The earth waits for the good news of the kingdom.
Laudetur Jesus Christus, and welcome to Vatican Media's coverage of Holy Mass with Pope Francis, live from St. Peter's Square on this, the second Sunday of Easter and the Feast of Divine Mercy. I'm Mary Shevlin. I'd like to welcome all of our listeners today, especially from Shalom World TV, EWTN, Salt and Light, Telecare, Catholic TV, and Radio Maria. And wherever you're joining us today, welcome and a blessed feast day to all of you. The entrance procession has begun. Pope Francis will arrive in just a few moments here in St. Peter's Square. As we continue the celebration of Easter, today ends the octave, the 8 days that we celebrate the Easter feast. The past 8 days have been each one like Easter Sunday. Here's Pope Francis now arriving in the square to greet the thousands of pilgrims who have come from all over the world to be here for today's feast. This Sunday, the second Sunday of Easter, has popularly been known as the Feast of Divine Mercy. And for whoever doesn't know the story, it's because between 1930 and 1938, Christ appeared to Sister Faustina, a Sister of Mercy in Poland. She began the Divine Mercy devotion at Jesus' request after a number of visions and private revelations to the Polish nun. Pope John Paul II, a Pole himself, canonized Sister Faustina April 30th in the year 2000, in that Jubilee year. And ever since, the second Sunday of Easter has been a celebration of God's divine mercy. Pope Francis making his way to the main altar here in the area just in front of St. Peter's Basilica, where he will venerate the altar with a kiss. As he does at the beginning of every Mass, Pope Francis venerating the crucifix, which is at the center of the altar, and he will make his way around it. And the incense, of course, symbolizing our prayers, which rise up to God during the Mass. We see the image of divine mercy. Christ with his hand on his heart and the other one raised in blessing. We see the rays, the red and the white rays, which are emanating forth from his sacred heart, his mercy being poured out for all. This is a vision given to Sister Faustina by our Lord, and he asks that this image be struck. We see many of the flowers adorning the piazza this morning, still from the Easter celebrations donated by the Netherlands. They have been adorning the square for most of the week. Just a reminder that we are still in the season of Easter, which we will continue to celebrate until the Feast of Pentecost.
Oh,
Pope Francis, coming now as we see the white roses at the base of the statue of Our Lady who holds on her lap the Christ child, Our Lady, Mother of Mercy, because she is the Mother of Christ. Peace be with you. Dear brothers and sisters, the Holy Father begins, let us invoke the blessing of God our Father, so that this rite of sprinkling may revive in us the grace of baptism, through which we have been immersed in the Lord's redemptive death in order to rise with him to new life. Francis is sprinkling the faithful with holy water. The rite of sprinkling, as the choir sings the hymn Vidi Aquam, which says, I saw water flowing out of the temple from its right side, Alleluia, and all who came to this water were saved, and they shall say, Alleluia, Alleluia. Of the sprinkling of the water is something that takes place during the Easter season, and as the Holy Father reminded us in the prayer just now, he prayed that this rite of sprinkling may revive in us the grace of baptism. May Almighty God cleanse us of our sins, and through the Eucharist we celebrate, make us worthy to participate in the banquet of his kingdom.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray.
Dio d'eterna misericordia, che nella ricorrenza.
God of everlasting mercy, who in the very recurrence of the Paschal feast rekindle the faith of the people you have made your own. Grant that we may understand the inestimable richness of baptism that purified us, of the Spirit that regenerated us, of the blood that redeemed us. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. We continue now with the liturgy of the word. Today's first reading will be read in English and is from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verses 32 to 35.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The whole group of believers was united, heart and soul. No one claimed for his own use anything that he had, as everything they owned was held in common. The apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus with great power, and they were all given great respect. None of their members was ever in want, as all those who owned land or houses would sell them and bring the money from them to present it to the apostles. It was then distributed to any members who might be in need.
Verbum Domini.
We continue now with the psalm. Today's psalm is Psalm 118.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Dica Israele il suo amore per sempre. Dica la casa di Aronne.
The psalm says, let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever.
La pietra scartata dai costruttori è divenuta la pietra d'angolo.
The stone which the builders rejected has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Preghiamo, Signore, dona la salvezza. Ti preghiamo, Signore, dona la vittoria. Benedetto colui che viene nel nome del Signore. Vi benediciamo dalla casa del Signore. Il Signore è Dio e ci illumina. Alleluia.
Continue now with the second reading, taking from the first letter of Saint John.
Lectura de la primera carta del apóstol San Juan. Queridos hermanos, Todo el que cree que Jesús es el Cristo ha nacido de Dios.
Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is a child of God. And everyone who loves the parent loves the child.
En esto conocemos que amamos a los hijos de Dios.
By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey His commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. And His commandments are not burdensome. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not with the water only, but with the water and the blood.
Porque el Espíritu es la verdad.
Verbum Domini.
Today, as we are still within the octave of Easter, as part of today's Mass, we now have this Easter sequence. We see many of the images focusing here on the Paschal candle. You see Jesus figured on the Paschal candle. Today's beautiful Easter sequence says, Christians to the Paschal victim offer sacrifice and praise. The sheep are ransomed by the Lamb, and Christ the undefiled hath sinners to his Father reconciled. The faithful now stand for the Alleluia as we prepare to hear today's Gospel. Francis placing incense into the censer and blessing it. The deacon will now come forth to receive Pope Francis's blessing before he proclaims today's Gospel. Deacon will now make his way to the main altar, which we see there, and take the book of the Gospels and solemnly process it to the ambo, where he will proclaim Today's reading taken from the Gospel of St. John. The book of the Gospels, processed in such a solemn way, truly speaks to God who was alive and present in his word. The Lord be with you.
Lectio Sancte Evangelii secundum Ioannem.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
La sera di quel giorno, il primo della settimana, mentre erano chiuse...
On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being shut where the disciples were, for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, Peace be with you. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the disciples told him, We have seen the Lord.
Se non vedo nelle sue mani il segno dei chiodi.
But he said to them, Unless I see in his hands the print of the nails, and place my finger in the mark of the nails, and place my hand in his side, I will not believe. Eight days later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. The doors were shut, but Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not be faithless, but believing. Thomas answered him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written, that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name.
Verbum Domini.
The deacon will now process the book of the Gospels back to Pope Francis, who will venerate it and bless all of those gathered here today with that. We see on the left side of the basilica area by Pope Francis many of the priests dressed in white, and many of those are the Missionaries of Mercy, this being the Feast of Divine Mercy. Some 550 Missionaries of Mercy appointed by Pope Francis have come to Rome for today's feast, as at Pope Francis's request. Process the book of the Gospels, place it in a place of honor as we prepare to hear Pope Francis's homily for this, the second Sunday of Easter and the Feast of Divine Mercy. In today's Gospel, we hear over and over the word see. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. They tell Thomas, we have seen the Lord. But the Gospel does not describe how they saw him. It does not describe the risen Jesus. It simply mentions one detail. He showed them his hands and his side. It is as if the Gospel wants to tell us that that is how the disciples recognized Jesus, through his wounds. The same thing happened to Thomas, who wanted to see the mark of the nails in his hands, and after seeing, he believed. Despite his lack of faith, we should be grateful to Thomas, because he was not content to hear from others that Jesus was alive, or merely to see him in the flesh, but he wanted to see inside, to touch with his hand the Lord's wounds, the signs of his love. The Gospel calls Thomas Didymus, which means twin. And in this, he is truly our twin brother, because for us too, it isn't enough to know that God exists. A God who has risen but remains distant does not fill our lives. An aloof God does not attract us, however just and holy he may be. No. We too need to see God, to touch him with our hands, and to know that he has risen and risen for us. And how can we see him? Like the disciples, through his wounds.
Quando lì si hanno compreso
che non li amava per scherzo.
Gazing upon those wounds, the disciples understood the depth of his love. It was no joke. They understood that he had forgiven them, and even though some had denied him and abandoned him, to enter into Jesus' wounds is to contemplate the boundless love flowing from his heart. It is to realize that his heart beats for me, for you, for each one of us. Dear brothers and sisters, we can consider ourselves Christians, call ourselves Christians, and speak about the many beautiful values of faith. But like the disciples, we need to see Jesus by touching his love. Only this way can we go to the heart of faith, and like the disciples, find peace and joy beyond all doubt.
Tommaso, dopo aver visto le piaghe del Signore, esclamò: Mio Signore, mio Dio.
Thomas, after seeing the Lord's wounds, cries out: My Lord and my God.
Mio.
I would like to reflect on the adjective that Thomas repeats: My. It is a possessive adjective. When we think about it, it might seem inappropriate to use it of God. How can God be mine? How can I make the Almighty mine? The truth is, by saying my, we do not profane God, but honor his mercy. Because God wished to become ours. As in a love story, we tell him, you became man for me. You died and rose for me. And thus, you are not only God, you are my God. You are my life. In you I have found the love I was looking for, and much more than I could have ever imagined. God takes no offense at being ours, because love demands confidence, mercy demands trust. At the very beginning of the Ten Commandments, God says, I am the Lord your God. And reaffirms, I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. Here we see how God presents himself as a jealous lover who calls himself your God. From the depths of Thomas's heart comes the reply, my Lord and my God. As today we enter, through Christ's wounds, into the mystery of God, we come to realize that mercy is not simply one of his qualities among others, but it is the very beating of his heart. Then, like Thomas, we no longer live as disciples, uncertain, devout, but wavering. We too fall in love with the Lord. Don't be afraid of this word, to fall in love. In love.
Come assaporare questo amore?
How can we savor this love? How can we touch today with our hand the mercy of Jesus? Again, the gospel offers a clue when it stresses that the very evening of Easter, soon after rising from the dead, Jesus begins by granting the Spirit for the forgiveness of sins. To experience love, we need to begin there, to let ourselves be forgiven. To let ourselves be forgiven. I ask myself, to myself, and I ask each one of you, do I let myself be forgiven?
quell'amore.
To experience that love, we have to begin there. Do I let myself be forgiven? But going to confession may seem difficult. Before God, we are tempted to do what the disciples did in the gospel, to barricade ourselves behind closed doors. They did it out of fear. And we too can be afraid, ashamed to open our hearts and confess our sins. May the Lord grant us the grace to understand shame, to see it not as a closed door, but as the first step towards an encounter. When we feel ashamed, we should be grateful. This means that we do not accept evil, and that is good. Shame is a secret invitation of the soul that needs the Lord to overcome evil. The tragedy is when we are no longer ashamed of anything. Let us not be afraid to experience shame, and let us pass from shame to forgiveness. Do not be afraid to be ashamed, to feel shame. Do not be afraid of that. But there is still one door that remains closed before the Lord's forgiveness, the door of resignation. That is always a closed door. The disciples experienced it at Easter, when they recognized with disappointment how everything appeared to go back to what it had been before. They were still in Jerusalem, disheartened. The Jesus chapter of their lives seemed finished, and after having spent so much time with him, nothing had changed. We give up. We too might think, I've been a Christian for a long time. Well, nothing changes for me. I keep committing the same sins. Then, discouraged, we give up on mercy. But the Lord challenges us. Don't you believe my mercy is greater than your misery? Are you a backslider when it comes to sin? Then be a backslider in asking for mercy, and we will see who comes out on top. In any event, and anyone who is familiar with the sacrament of reconciliation knows this, it isn't true that everything remains the way it was. Even every time we are forgiven, we are reassured and encouraged, because each time we experience more love. And when we fall again, precisely because we are loved, we experience even greater sorrow, a beneficial sorrow that slowly detaches us from sin. Then we discover that the power of life is to receive God's forgiveness and to go forward from forgiveness to forgiveness. And this is life. Shame, shame, forgiveness, forgiveness. And this is the Christian life. After shame and resignation, there is another closed door. Sometimes it is even ironclad. Our sin. The same sin. When I commit a grave sin, if I, in all honesty, do not want to forgive myself, why should God forgive me? This door, however, is only closed on one side, our side. But for God, no door is ever completely closed. As the gospel tells us, he loves to enter precisely through closed doors. When every entrance seems barred, there God works his wonders. He never chooses to abandon us. We are the ones who keep him out. But when we make our confession, something unheard of happens. We discover that the very sin that kept us apart from the Lord becomes the place where we encounter him. There, the God who is wounded by love comes to meet our wounds. He makes our wretched wounds like his own glorious wounds. There's a transformation. My wound becomes like his glorious wounds, because he is mercy and works wonders in our wretchedness. Let us today, like Thomas, implore the grace to acknowledge our God, to find in his forgiveness our joy, and in his mercy our hope. Pope Francis concluding his homily. This is the second Sunday of Easter and the Feast of Divine Mercy, and the faithful are now invited to remain for a moment in silence as we reflect on the readings and also Pope Francis's very moving homily, where he once again reminds us it is never God who abandons us, it is we who close the door to him. As Pope Francis reminds us, God will always find a way around that door and through that door to bring us his mercy. We need only to ask for it. And as always, he mentions the importance of going to the sacrament of reconciliation. And then our wounds become transformed and become like Christ's glorious wounds. Pope Francis saying, the very sin that kept us apart from the Lord becomes the place where we meet him. There, the God who is wounded by love, he said, comes to meet our wounds. The Mass continues now with the Creed. Dear brothers, with faith in Jesus Christ, the living resurrected one who has conquered the world, let us trustingly raise our prayer to God. The first prayer of the faithful, read in German, says, God, Father of mercy, make your children one heart and one soul. And may your church give witness to all of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus.
Boże, Ojcze miłosierdzia.
Second prayer in Polish says, God, Father of mercy, inspire those who govern with the keen desire to serve the people entrusted to them with freedom and generosity, so that no one is deprived of the necessities of life. We pray to the Lord.
Deus, Pai de misericórdia.
This prayer in Portuguese says, God, the Father of mercy, overcome the hardness of heart of unbelievers and give every man new eyes capable of recognizing Jesus, Lord and God. We pray to the Lord.
Dieu, Père de miséricorde.
This prayer in French says, God, Father of mercy, reach sinful man with the liberating truth of your gospel and with the consoling grace of your forgiveness. We pray to the Lord. This prayer in Chinese says, God, Father of mercy, raise up new imitators of Jesus, obedient servant, and open the hands of believers to charity, that they may be ready to take care of the wounds of every brother. We pray to the Lord. Welcome, Father, the prayer of the Church that invokes the gift of the Holy Spirit and professes faith in Jesus, Lord and God, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. After the prayer of faithful, we now continue with the liturgy of the Eucharist. see many of the ministers here who will help distribute communion throughout the square. Again, for the thousands who have come to be here for today's Feast of Divine Mercy and the second Sunday of Easter. The altar is being prepared. The Eucharistic prayer today will be prayed in Italian, Eucharistic prayer number 3, and we will leave that in the Italian as we focus on the great miracle that takes place here during every Mass, and we will leave that without commentary and pick up when we pray together the Our Father. And here we see now some of the faithful bringing the gifts forward, some families who have been chosen for this honor today. Francis taking a moment to greet the mother and father and their young children. Pope Francis not only blessing the gifts they brought forward for the Mass, blessing each one of them as well. And the last family coming up now with very small children, Pope Francis blessing the chalice. And as he always does, taking time to bless the smallest ones who is lovingly asleep on her mother's shoulder. Another family, we have to recall, any of you following this beautiful Mass today, that there will be a world meeting dedicated to families taking place in Dublin, Ireland this August. You can read more about that on vaticannews.va, and just the importance of family and how we can better serve them and all of their needs. It'll be a very important event taking place this year. Again, that's the world meeting of families, and how wonderful to see these beautiful families here this morning. That have been brought up to be blessed by Pope Francis have now been brought to the altar. Pope Francis now making his way down to the altar as well. On a very beautiful day, a perfect day for this one beautiful Feast of Divine Mercy, we see the beautiful Easter flowers as we continue to celebrate Easter today. And as we join together now in prayer for the liturgy of the Eucharist, again, we will leave the prayers in the Italian for you, and we'll pick up together when Pope Francis reminds us and invites us to pray the Our Father. Thank you.
Grazie fratelli, perché il mio e vostro sacrificio sia gradito a Dio Padre Onnipotente. Cogli in comodità, Signore, l'offerta del tuo popolo. Tu che ci hai chiamati alla fede e rigenerati nel battesimo, guidaci alla felicità eterna. Per Cristo nostro Signore.
Amen.
Signore, sia con voi.
E con il tuo
Spirito. In alto i nostri cuori.
Sono rivolti al Signore.
Ne diamo grazie, Signore nostro Dio.
E cosa buona e giusta.
Veramente cosa buona e giusta, nostro dovere e fonte di salvezza, proclamare sempre la tua gloria, o Signore, soprattutto esaltarti in questo giorno nel quale Cristo, nostra Pasqua, si è immolato. E lui è il vero agnello che ha tolto i peccati del mondo. E lui che morendo ha distrutto la morte e risorgendo ha ridato a noi la vita. Per questo mistero, nella pienezza della gioia pasquale, l'umanità esulta su tutta la terra e con l'assemblea degli angeli e dei santi canta l'inno della tua gloria. Padre veramente santo, a te la lode da ogni creatura. Per mezzo di Gesù Cristo, tuo Figlio, nostro Signore, la potenza dello Spirito Santo, fai vivere e santifichi l'universo e continui a radunare intorno a te un popolo che da un confine all'altro della terra offre al tuo nome il sacrificio perfetto. Ora ti preghiamo umilmente, manda il tuo Spirito a santificare i doni che ti offriamo, perché che diventino il corpo e il sangue di Gesù Cristo, tuo Figlio e nostro Signore, che ci ha comandato di celebrare questi misteri. Nella notte in cui fu tradito, egli prese il pane, ti rese grazie con la preghiera di benedizione. Lo spezzò, lo diede ai suoi discepoli e disse: prendete e mangiatene tutti. Questo è il mio corpo, offerto in sacrificio per voi. Dopo la cena, allo stesso modo, prese il calice, ti desse grazie con la preghiera di benedizione, lo diede ai suoi discepoli e disse: prendete e bevetene tutti. Questo è il calice del mio sangue, per la nuova ed eterna alleanza, versato per voi e per tutti in remissione dei peccati. Fate questo in memoria di me.
Mistero della fede.
Celebrando il memoriale del tuo Figlio, morto per la nostra salvezza, gloriosamente risorto e asceso al cielo, nella testa della sua venuta, ti offriamo, Padre, in rendimento di grazie, questo sacrificio vivo e santo. Guarda con amore e riconosci nell'offerta della tua Chiesa la vittima immolata per la nostra redenzione. E a noi che ci nutriamo del corpo e sangue del tuo Figlio, dona la pienezza dello Spirito Santo, perché diventiamo in Cristo un solo corpo e un solo Spirito.
Egli faccia di noi un sacrificio perenne a te gradito, perché possiamo ottenere il regno promesso insieme con i tuoi eletti, con la Beata Maria Vergine e Madre di Dio, con San Giuseppe suo sposo, con i tuoi santi apostoli, i gloriosi martiri, e tutti i santi nostri intercessori presso di te.
Per questo sacrificio di riconciliazione, dona Padre, pace e salvezza al mondo intero. Conferma nella fede e nell'amore la tua Chiesa pellegrina sulla terra, il tuo servo e nostro Papa Francesco, il Collegio Episcopale, tutto il clero e il popolo che tu hai redento. Ascolta la preghiera di questa famiglia che hai convocato alla tua presenza nel giorno glorioso della resurrezione del Cristo Signore, nel suo vero corpo. Ricongiungi a te, Padre misericordioso, tutti i tuoi figli ovunque dispersi. Accogli nel tuo regno i nostri fratelli defunti e tutti i giusti che in pace con te hanno lasciato questo mondo. Concede anche a noi di ritrovarci insieme a godere per sempre della tua gloria. In Cristo nostro Signore, per mezzo del quale, o Dio, doni al mondo ogni bene.
Per Cristo, con Cristo e in Cristo, a te Dio Padre Onnipotente, nell'unità dello Spirito Santo, ogni onore e gloria per tutti i secoli dei secoli.
Mediante alla parola del Salvatore e formati
a suo diviso, to join in praying together the Our Father.
Padre nostro, qui es in cielis,
peccatoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentatione, sed libera nos a malo.
Liberaci, o Signore, da tutti i mali. Concedi la pace ai nostri giorni. Con l'aiuto della Tua misericordia vivremo sempre liberi dal peccato e sicuri da ogni turbamento, nell'attesa che si compia la beata speranza e venga il nostro Salvatore Gesù Cristo. Signore Gesù Cristo, che hai detto ai tuoi apostoli, vi lascio la pace e vi do la mia pace. Non guardare ai nostri peccati, ma alla fede della tua Chiesa, e donale unità e pace, secondo la tua volontà, tu che vivi e regni nei secoli dei secoli.
Amen.
La pace del Signore sia sempre con voi.
E con il tuo spirito.
Offerte vobis pace.
The deacon now inviting all of those present to exchange a sign of peace. We see Pope Francis exchanging a sign of peace with concelebrants. We see there Archbishop Rino Fisichella, who heads up the Vatican's Office for the New Evangelization and is in charge of the Missionaries of Mercy. They're commissioning, they're sending forth, and they're having, they had a conference this week here in the Eternal City before today's Mass. They've been meeting for the past few days and with the Holy Father as well as they continue their work as Missionaries of Mercy. So we see Archbishop Fisichella there, Pope Francis greeting the other concelebrants with him there on the altar. And we pray now the Agnus Dei, Lamb of God.
Beati gli invitati alla cena del Signore. Ecco l'agnello di Dio che toglie i peccati del mondo.
O Signore,
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Pope Francis receiving communion and the faithful as well. As we see the priests who have made their way out through the crowds here in St. Peter's Square. And a beautiful atmosphere of prayer has been maintained, though we are outside and such a beautiful day. The faithful who are here to pray. They're here to listen to God's word and celebrate this feast of divine mercy.
Thank you.
the faithful receive communion. And we mentioned at the beginning of the broadcast that today is the Feast of Divine Mercy, based on revelations that were given to a Polish nun from 1930 to 1938. Christ appeared to Sister Faustina, who belonged to the Sisters of Mercy. And in those visions, Jesus requested that devotion be spread to his mercy. And on the Sunday after Easter, we saw there's an image adorning the square. Maybe some of you know it well, the famous image of Jesus, the Divine Mercy, which was actually painted at Christ's request, according to the private revelation approved by the church, that this message be painted according to the image that Sister Faustina was shown. And this image is loved and venerated throughout the world, and it speaks so much to us about God's mercy by just looking at it. And what better time to reflect on divine mercy than during the Easter season? Christ, who wrought our salvation through his passion, death, and resurrection, opened for us the gates of heaven, enabling us to become children of God. All of that being celebrated today. Also present, which you'll see up near the altar with Pope Francis today, are priests who are missionaries of mercy, priests in dioceses throughout the world. But some have been chosen to be called these missionaries of mercy with a very special mandate. The bull of indiction, called Misericordiae Vultus, which means the face of mercy. These priests who are in dioceses throughout the world, there's about 1,000 of them. About half of them are here present today. Half of them were able to be here. And basically, they are at the disposal of their local bishop within their diocese and their countries throughout the world. And with particular emphasis, of course, on the sacrament of reconciliation. And in a special way, they have been granted the faculty, the ability to pardon even those sins that are usually reserved to the Holy See, to the Vatican. They are appointed by the Holy Father, and something that was originally thought to just happen during the Jubilee of Mercy, which you remember, in 2016. The Holy Father decided at the end of the Jubilee of Mercy that these missionaries of mercy would continue their important work throughout the world. And so they have been meeting here this week to hear how their work has been going, and to reflect on how better to be servants of Christ's mercy. Following this on television, the image of divine mercy. Christ has his left hand on his heart, pointing to his heart, from where two large rays come forth, one red and the other one is white or pale. And the other hand of Christ is raised in blessing. Those of us following along on TV, radio, or social media, while the faithful here are receiving communion, we like to continue to pray and reflect on the words that Pope Francis spoke during his homily. Today's gospel, of course, focusing on Thomas, Doubting Thomas, as he is known throughout the world. Pope Francis said the name Thomas means twin. And Pope Francis called him our twin brother because he said, for us too, it isn't just enough to know God exists. For example, a God who has risen but remains distant, Pope Francis says, does not fill our lives. An aloof God does not attract us, however just and holy he may be. Pope Francis said, no, we too need to see God, to touch him with our hands, and to know that he is risen for us. Francis continued, reflecting on how God wishes to become ours, he said, like in a love story. He said, we tell him, you became man for me, you died and rose for me, and thus you are not only God, you are my life. In you I have found the love I was looking for and much more than I ever could have imagined. Pope Francis said, here we can see, in, like, for example, in the Ten Commandments, when the Lord said, I am the Lord your God, and I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. Pope Francis said, in this way, Jesus presents himself as a jealous lover who calls himself your God. And he pointed out how Thomas, the cry from Thomas's heart that came forth was, my Lord and my God. And Pope Francis said, today, as we enter through Christ's wounds, as Thomas did, into the mystery of God, we come to realize that mercy is not simply one of God's qualities among others, but it is the very beating of his heart. Pope Francis continued saying, then, like Thomas, we no longer live as disciples, uncertain, devout, and wavering, but said we too fall in love with the Lord. Praying, collected in prayer after communion. One of the questions to us in his homily today, he said, don't you believe, he said, the Lord challenges us by saying, don't you believe that my mercy is greater than your misery? Asking us if we thought of ourselves as backsliders, and he said, then be a backslider in asking for mercy. And we will see who comes out on top, he said.
Rimaniamo alcuni istanti in silenzio orante.
The faithful being invited now to remain in prayerful silence after communion. Through communion, we receive the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus, and it is important, as Pope Francis points out, to have these moments of silence, to truly commune with our Lord in communion. When we become a tabernacle for his presence. There are many feasts of the image, there are many images of the Divine Mercy, Christ, the Divine Mercy image that are adorning the piazza today. We see one towards the back there. Part of the Divine Mercy festivities in Rome will be a holy hour. Just down the street from this piazza, just about a 5-minute walk, not even, to the church designated by Pope St. John Paul II to be the shrine of Divine Mercy here in Italy, just down the street from the Vatican at the Church of the Holy Spirit. So there'll be a holy hour there today at 3.
Preghiamo.
Let us pray.
Dio onnipotente, la forza del sacramento pasquale che abbiamo ricevuto.
Almighty God, may the strength of the Paschal sacrament that we have received continue to operate in our lives. We ask this through Christ our Lord. We now have the Regina Coeli.
Cari fratelli e sorelle, prima della benedizione finale,
dear brothers and sisters, before the final blessing, we will turn to our Heavenly Mother in prayer. But before that, I want to thank all of you who have participated in this celebration, in particular, the Missionaries of Mercy, who have come together for their meeting. Thank you. Thank you for your service.
Ai nostri fratelli e sorelle delle chiese orientali che
to our brothers and sisters of the Eastern churches who celebrate the solemnity of Easter today, according to the Julian calendar, I extend my most cordial best wishes. May the risen Lord fill them with light and peace and comfort those communities who live in particularly difficult situations. In a special way, I greet those present who are Rom or Sinti on the occasion of their International Romani Day, known as Romano Dives. I bid peace and harmony to these people who belong to these ancient peoples, and hope that each day might foster a culture of encounter with the goodwill of knowing each other and respecting each other reciprocally. This is the path that brings true integration. Dear Rom and Sinti, pray for me, and let us pray together for your Syrian brothers and sisters who are refugees. I greet all of the other pilgrims present here, parish groups, families, associations, and together we place ourselves under the mantle of Mary, Mother of Mercy. We'll pray together now the Regina Coeli, Queen of Heaven, rejoice, which takes the place of the traditional Angelus during this Easter season. Francis, bring the Regina Coeli in front of the statue of Mary present in the piazza today for today's celebration. His blessing that he will give now at the end of this celebration extends to all of you following on TV, radio, and social media.
Deus qui per resurrectionem fili tui domini nostri Jesu Christi, monum letificare dignatus es, presta questum.
God, who by the resurrection of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, has vouchsafed to make glad the whole world, grant, we beseech thee, that through the intercession of the Virgin Mary, his mother, we may attain the joys of eternal life.
Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto. Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto.
Sicut erat in principio et nunc et semper et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Pro fidelibus defuntis, requiem aeternam donaeis, Domine.
Et lux perpetua lucere eis.
Requiescat. In pace.
Again, the blessing. This will be the final blessing, and it extends to all of you as well.
Giungono dalla Siria.
From Syria, we are hearing terrible news of bombings with dozens of victims, of whom many are women and children. News about many people who are being affected by chemical substances which were contained in these bombs. Let us pray for all of those who have died, for the wounded, for the families who are suffering. There is not a good or bad war, and nothing can justify the use of these arms that exterminate against people and persons. Let us pray. Those who are responsible, the politicians and the military, can choose another path, that of negotiation, which can only bring peace. That alone can bring peace, and not that of death and destruction.
Domino Hoviscum.
Et Spiritu Tuo.
Sin Domini Benedictum.
Et so concredusque in secolo.
Aiutorium nostrum in nomine Domini.
Qui feci celum et terra.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
Ite missa est, alleluia, alleluia.
And with that final blessing, Pope Francis gave us the final blessing, which extends once more to all of us following this on TV, radio, and social media. Let us recall his words at the end of today's Mass, this Feast of Mercy, Pope Francis calling for an end to the atrocities which are happening in Syria. These in response to reports Rescue were saying that on Sunday that a poison gas attack on a rebel town near the capital has killed at least 40 people, allegations which are being denied by the Syrian government. But these reports, Pope Francis responding to those, praying for the families, praying for those who are mourning, for those who have died, and saying there is no war that is good or evil, no, and nothing can justify the use of these weapons. You can check back in with vaticannews.va. Go to our website. We'll have more on the Holy Father's words later today. From all of us here at Vatican News, thank you for following this broadcast of Vatican Media. I'm Mary Shovlin. I wish you all a very blessed second Sunday of Easter and the Feast of Divine Mercy. Thank you so much for joining us. Laudetur Jesus Christus.